matter how hard you try, you don't have the power to change your past. No one can. What's done is done. Therefore, the only thing you can do is to accept it, learn from it, and move on. Hello and welcome back to this channel. So today I want to talk about the past. Most of us, we live in our past. I want to talk about how holding on to the past can ruin your life, and I hope you get to learn from what I'm going to say. And please subscribe before we continue. I hope you find this video helpful. So it is always said that those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it. This clearly made to this statement, particularly when the past is being used as an empowerment tool to ameliorate the future. However, what happens when all we remember and are focused on is the past? Ask yourself that. When this occurs, we wind up getting stuck in the past and we forfeit the opportunity to create greater success in our future. Whether we are perpetually beating ourselves up about mistakes we made, regretting a lost opportunity, lingering in the pain about being abused, victimized, or damned, mourning a loss, or even resting on our achievements, these are all very dangerous emotional territories to permanently abide in. Why? It is akin to telling ourselves that we can never rise above or experience anything better than the bad things that might have occurred in the past. Consequently, we become binded to the options and opportunities in front of us, as well as our ability to leverage our potential to achieve great things in the future. In short, an auspicious future essentially becomes non-existent when we choose to stay in our past and we refuse to move forward. So, what are the ways we relive our past? One of them is recreate. We fail to step out from the shadows of our past is by recreating environments and dynamics that are similar to those we experienced when growing up or when we were still young. This pattern can be tricky to identify. However, we may find ourselves somehow dating or marrying people who treat us in the ways that are similar to how we were treated as kids. For example, if we grew up with a parent who made us feel small or insignificant, we may find ourselves attracted to partners who are more dismissive. If we had a parent who fawned over us, we may only feel drawn to people who build us up. Another way we recreate past dynamics is by distorting figures in our lives and projecting traits or reactions onto them that come from our history. For instance, if we had an untrustworthy, flaky, or rejecting person in our early lives, we may consistently feel we are being deceived as others. We may assume our partner is pulling away or cheating on us, even when we are, even when there are no signs that that is the case. Lastly, on recreating, we may even unconsciously provoke people in our lives to react to us in ways that are similar, even though they were painful. If we were seen as babyish or incompetent as kids, for instance, we may find ourselves acting more helpless or needy with our partner or even people around us. If we had a parent who lost his or her temper, we may try to provide that same reaction out of the people we are closer to in our adult lives by insulting them or trying to push their buttons, knowing very well that they will react. The second way of living our past is by reacting. For example, if we hated the way our parents did not get along, we may grow up writing off relationships or love in general. We may vow to never get too serious with someone or trust anyone on a deep level. Or if we felt deprived as kids, we may try to make up for it by overindulging or spoiling our own children. The opposite side of the same coin comes when we rebel against our parents' way of being. Once again, it's healthy and wise to identify traits we don't like in our early caretakers, to choose to be different in these ways. However, we sometimes are so determined to be different from our family of origin that we overcompensate or distort our natural way of being. We may project onto our kids that they feel like we did when we were young, and therefore react to them in ways that are misattuned to their actual wants and needs. In each of these cases, we are still seeing the present through a filter of our past and failing to separate ourselves from our history. We are not following, or we are not allowing ourselves to fully realize who we really are and what we really want with our lives. The third way of reliving our past is through repeating. For example, if we had an especially elusive or inward parent, we may find ourselves feeling unavailable to our loved ones or pulling away from relationships when they get too close. If we had a parent who worried excessively and intruded on us, we may find ourselves feeling the same way toward our children and acting in ways that are invasive or overbearing. We carry on our past in the present by repeating behaviors and taking on characteristics of important figures in our early lives. It can be a good thing when we are adopting ways of being that we value and respect. However, we have a tendency to over-identify with the negative traits of our parents or early caretakers. We actually struggle to surpass or see ourselves in a different light from the people who originally cared for us in our early lives. So, on an unconscious level, we take on our parents' traits in an effort to preserve a romanticized image of themselves. While it may seem counterintuitive, it can actually feel painful or threatening to separate ourselves from our parents by seeing them realistically, including all the ways they were limited or all the ways that they hurt us as maybe kids or at some point in our lives. Instead, we identify with our parents and take on their qualities. So, in light of this, how can we avoid letting the past wreck our future? Here are some of the things to remember so that we can circumvent getting stuck in the past and missing out on the vast potential of our future. I want you to listen carefully to the next steps that you can take to help you get away from your past and substantially move forward with your life. So, number one, remember the past is only data. That is it. We treat the past like it's a powerful, living, breathing entity that is like a dominion over us. But the reality is that the past is merely data. We fully have the power to use that data wisely or discard the data if it is not empowering. When we treat the past as though it is superior to us, then it will haunt us and taunt us ad infinitum, if you know that. It is important to remember that the past is entirely filled with outdated data. As such, we should avoid putting a premium on the past while discounting the present, which is where all the opportunities to maximize our future potential lie. The point is that in order to evolve, we must focus on the power of the present. I know this is easier said than done, but we must find the courage to stand up to it and take charge of it. No matter how painful or traumatizing the past might have been, we have the ability to get unstuck from it. It does not matter how we were in the past, because the present and the future has the nourishment that will give us the strength to survive. To find that nourishment, we must surround ourselves with the right people and put in the work that is required to strengthen our survival muscles. The second point on how to survive or unstuck yourself from your past is that you must remember this. The past is finite, while the future is boundless. The past is just the past. It's finite. It is defined. But what about the future? The future is very broad and very boundless. So the past is finite with all the chapters already completed. We cannot make it better or worse than it was. It really is what it is. However, the future is boundless and teeming with potential. The great thing about life is that we have choices, and with the passage of time, we can evolve if we choose wisely. We all make mistakes and have had things that happen to us. That said, in order for us to tap into this unbridled potential of the future, we must choose to be more intentional about not making our future identical to our past. Hence, we must be willing to embrace change. We have the power to change our path with the choices we make each day. We can evict the past from our future lives. When we do this, we open up our lives to new hope, new mindset, new friends, new places, new experiences, new hobbies, new challenges, and new laurels. Laurels in this sense means success. We have to find the courage to clean house, because we simply cannot change our future if the past is still the biggest and most vociferous occupier in our lives. And the third thing to remind yourself to get yourself out of your past is, we do not get rid of our past. If we do not get rid of our past, then the past will get rid of us. How? Sometimes our past is wired to wreck our future, and we have to fight tooth and nail to avoid the carnage. Why might ask, can we really get rid of our past? Yes, it is possible. We get rid of it, not by attempting to rewrite it, but by silencing it with newer and better experiences. Therefore, everything in the past that left us disenfranchised, we do something today that will empower us in days to come. We should as well stop giving the past as much attention and power. Quite often, we treat it like a victor by constantly talking and shining the spotlight on it. All this does is to strengthen the past. We mistakenly give the past a microphone, and it delightfully use it to criticize us and mock us badly. Other times, we give the past various weapons that it ruthlessly uses against us. When we give the past all this power and attention, it will dominate and destroy our lives. We have to create new experiences that overshadow our past until it ceases to become a threat to our present and future. It is true, we cannot rewrite our past, but we can avoid constantly rereading into it, particularly if it is defined by negativity. The ultimate goal here is to insulate our self-esteem from the destruction that a terroristic past can always inflict on us. An Arab proverb reminds us to write the bad things that happened to us in the sand so that they can be erased easily from our memory. That means that when the winds come, they carry the things that we write in the sand away with it. So most of us engrave the bad things that happened to us in the deepest places, meaning our painful memories remain immortalized in our minds. We walk around flaunting our mistakes, failures, our hurts, our disappointments, for us to live fully in the present and adequately ready the future. We need to draw lessons from the painful memories of our past and then let go. Which brings me to the fourth and the last point on how to get out of your past: letting go. So let go of the past so that you can be free and move from the shackles on your ankles which weigh you down. Forgive yourself and others. Don't burn your precious time dwelling on the past events. Life is so short, with lots of goals to achieve. Focus on them instead. As we come to the end of this video, I wish to remind you that no matter how hard you try, you don't have the power to change your past. No one can. What's done is done. Therefore, the only thing you can do is to accept it, learn from it, and move on. So, if you don't do this, ask yourself this question: how long do you have to live this life? So, I bet you don't know, and I bet I also don't know as a person. So, what do you want to do with your life that you still have to live if you keep on staying and dwelling in your past? If you can answer that, then I hope you get what you're looking for, but the past is the past. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. I hope you find this video helpful. Please subscribe, share, and comment. I hope you learn something. Bye-bye until next time.